I want to welcome you to our weekend experience. Today marks week two of the new series, Behind the Wheel, that Pastor Eli started last week. Now, if you haven't yet caught up on it, maybe you didn't listen to the first message, I encourage you to check us out. You can listen to the podcast on the RWC Church app. You can check us out on YouTube. The channel is RWC Springfield, and just listen and receive and take notes, and that way you'll be able to put the two messages together and just see how the whole series flows together. So I cannot wait to listen to today's message and how it's going to impact me and change my thought process throughout this week to come. Now, if you're watching us for the very first time, I gotta say welcome. I just have to stop what I'm doing right now and say welcome. We're excited to have you with us. You could have been doing anything today. You could have been scrolling through social media, YouTube, the internet, and somehow you ended up here. And so we don't take that for granted. It's a really big deal for us, and we're excited to have you with us. Now, for those of you who are part of the RWC family, or you've been friends of the RWC family for a little while, you know that this is week two of our drive-in services at our Boston Road location. If you'd like to participate in those, we encourage you to register, and you can do so right on our website, rwcchurch.com. And right on the homepage, you'll find information and instructions on how you too can register to go to our in-person services. However, you have decided to join us online. And I gotta say, we don't take that for granted. It's a big deal for us that you choose to have a date with us week after week right here online. And I was gonna say, you know, we're family, we're friends, we love it. So let us know in the comments below where you are watching us from. You know, in the New Testament, Jesus calls us to spread the gospel throughout the world. And so I wanna take a second and challenge you to be part of that. Be part of spreading the gospel, and it's as simple as clicking the share button. click the share button, whether you're on YouTube, on Facebook, go ahead and click that share button so that your friends and family know that there is something exciting happening on the RWC side of the internet, and it's time for worship. Now, as we get ready to worship, let's pray. God, thank you for this opportunity that you've given us to come together, worship your name, receive what you have for us today, give unto you, Lord. I pray for every person who's connected with us in this moment as part of this experience. I pray, Lord, for their purpose. I pray, God, for breakthrough in their life. I pray for answered prayers, for provision, for health, Lord, and I thank you because they are here today. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Enjoy this time of worship.
Come on, church, let's worship.
Risen, he's risen, forever glorified. Risen, he's risen, King Jesus, King Jesus is alive. Whoa.
Jesus, we live in higher, we serve a risen Savior, risen, he's risen.
Jesus, because you reign on high. Hallelujah. Thank you for this time of worship. We thank you, Father, because we can lift up your name. We can shout your praise. We can get together, whether it be virtually or in person, Father, and we can just declare your greatness, Father. Right now, we prepare our hearts to receive what you have in store for us. We are ready to receive your word, Father, your manna. In your matchless name, we pray, Father, and we thank you, Jesus. Amen and amen.
We're back. Thank you, RWC Worship. You guys are the real MVPs. We love you so much. Now it's that time of the service where we get to worship God with our tithes and offerings. But I really wanted to share with you a right now testimony that's happening in my life right now. So on my personal social media accounts, I was actually telling all of my friends there recently that my husband lost his job last fall. And he didn't have a job for several months, and it was a difficult time. You know, we weren't sure like where things were gonna come from, how bills were gonna get paid, but we remained faithful to God. We remained tithing and giving and serving in our church and just believing God for provision. And I have to say, friends, at the end of 2 months, when our savings were finally depleted, a job just fell right into his lap. Literally, just, hi. Here's a job for you. And so we ran with it. We received that blessing and we were so thankful for that. And then several months later, the world comes to a stop. The world stops with COVID-19. And there we were again with the uncertainty of what's going to happen with our jobs, with everything that's going on, as I'm sure that many of you also experienced. However, through it all, we remained faithful with our tithing, our giving, our offering, our service to the Lord and to the community. And I've got to say, to this day, God has provided for us in ways that I could never have imagined. And so I know that part of that is God's faithfulness. And because we sow a seed of faith in God, his faithfulness is so much bigger than ours. And I want to challenge your faith and I want to encourage your faith with our personal story. So as you get ready to give today, let's pray. God, I thank you for your faithfulness, for your ability to provide for us. The word tells us that if you provide for the birds of the sky, how much not more for us who are your children? And we thank you for that. We thank you for your provision and for your love and care for us. As we give to you, Lord, we pray that the kingdom be expanded, not just in Springfield, but beyond. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Enjoy this time of giving.
Thank you.
God bless you, RWC, and welcome to week two of this series that we have titled Behind the Wheel. Before I jump into today's teaching, let's do what we always do. Let us pray. Let us prepare our hearts to receive God's word. Father, we thank you for the opportunity that you give us to be in your presence, to be able to lift up your name, one church in different locations. And as we go into today's word, God, I pray that you would reveal yourself in a mighty, tangible way. Have, Lord, absolute control of everything that is done. May you draw unto you all those that would be saved. We thank you and we pray this in the matchless name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. I want to challenge you, as I always do, to open up the RWC Church app right there. Follow along with the message notes so that we can grow together. What an exciting time for us. It is week two of this series. It is also week two of Drive-In Church. So if you have not been a part of it, you still have an opportunity, whether it's drive-in, whether it's sitting down, as we go into phase two of our regathering. But we're going to have more information on that throughout the week. So we started this series last week, and I want to just kind of give a quick summary of what we've covered thus far. So when I think about the objective of this series, I'll remind you that one of the phrases that you'll hear us say over and over again here at RWC is that God has prepared a journey for you. He's prepared a journey for you. As a matter of fact, the Christian walk can best be described as a journey. So this series is going to really tackle that, but it's a series about surrendering control of your journey to God. When I say journey, it is synonymous with your life, but it's also synonymous with the plans that God has for your life. So as we surrender control of this journey, my prayer is that you would let God really be behind the wheel of your life. There has to be an exchange from you controlling to letting God truly be the author and the consumer, the one that guides every one of your steps. So last week, what I did is I began to show you throughout the Bible that God, every time that he has spoken, whether it be to a people, whether it be to a specific person, he has declared more than once this journey. So we spoke about Moses, the great Moses, and God gives an instruction to Moses so that he can speak to the people. Jewish people know this as the four I will statements. And here, what we see is God's original intention for you and for me. Let's pick it up once again at Exodus chapter 6, verse 6 and 7. Therefore, say to the Israelites, I am the Lord, and I will bring you out. Number one, the first thing that God does, he's going to bring you out, right? So for the people of God, he was promising that he would bring them out of Egypt. That is the very first thing that God does. He wants to bring you out. And that, last week we covered that. It's all about salvation. And then the second thing, he's going to bring you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians. And then here's the second I will statement. I will free you from being slaves to them. And then I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with mighty acts of judgment. So once again, the first I will, God is going to bring you out. The second I will that God promises is to free you. And that's deliverance. That's what we're going to talk about today. The third I will statement is I will redeem you. And that's all about redemption, going back to God's original intent. And then look at what the Bible says. Verse 7. I will take you out. I will take you as my own people. So that's all about community. And we're going to cover that on week 4. So he will take you out, speaking to the Israelites. I will take you as my own people and I will be your God. Then you will know that I am the Lord, your God, who brought you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians. So as a church, as our church, we have structured our vision on the concept of a spiritual journey. And we're all on a journey. So when you look at our very vision, we exist, RWC exists. Look what it says, RWC exists to connect believers and the unchurched with their divine purpose, so together we can make a difference. So we exist as a ministry to connect believers and the unchurched, those that have no knowledge of God, with their divine purpose, so that together we can make a difference. So it's important for you to know that. Now, last week, and if you haven't heard week one of this series, everything that we're talking about is built on it's in progression, so you have to get all of it. So one of the things that I told you last week is that throughout this series, I want you to ask yourself two questions. Number one, the first question is, am I moving? Like, if this is a journey, then surely God would want us to use momentum and use being in the atmosphere of sound teaching and a word that challenges you, that brings you from where you are to where God wants you to be. So maybe you haven't settled your yesterday. Maybe that's where God would want you to move. Or maybe you're on the sidelines and God is calling you to maybe do something for the kingdom. So the first question is, are we moving? Are you moving? The second question is, what is my next step? So the first one is, am I moving? The second one is, what is my next step? You being able to identify your next step will help you greatly. So as you hear these teachings, maybe your next step is baptism. Maybe your next step is to be a part of a small group. Maybe your next step is the Growth Track. And we're going to be launching Growth Track online, as well as the Freedom Curriculum small group online as well. So maybe that is your next step. So the first step of this journey, God makes a promise. And it is the promise of salvation. I want to bring you out of Egypt. But then today, we're going to cover the second promise that God does, and that is, I am going to free you, meaning deliverance. So the first step is all about salvation. We covered it last week. The second step is all about deliverance. Now, when we hear the word deliverance, I know that it may have a scary connotation, but today I'm going to show you that it should not scare you. See, the people of God were out of Egypt, but Egypt was not out of them. Look at what the Bible says in the book of Exodus, chapter 14, verse 10 through 12. Follow along. They cried out to the Lord and they said to Moses, "Why did you bring us out here to die in the wilderness? Weren't there enough graves for us in Egypt? What have you done to us?" Look at what it says. "What have you done to us? Why did you make us leave Egypt?" And then I love this. Look at what it says. "Didn't we tell you this would happen while we were still in Egypt? We said, 'Leave us alone. Let us be slaves to the Egyptians. It's better to be a slave in Egypt than a corpse in the wilderness.'" Now, if we could just kind of wrap our head around this, it's a little bit bewildering, because the people of God, from the very foundation of Abraham, Genesis chapter 12, God promises that he would make out of Abraham not only a family, but a nation. Not just a nation, but a thriving nation. A nation that would not borrow, but that would lend. A nation that would be known all around the world, speaking of Israel. So now they're no longer just a people. Now God has promised that he's going to take them to a promised land, a land that flows with milk and honey, which is synonymous with prosperity and health and well-being. So this is the promise that God has for them. So they are dealing with this, and yet when they're in the wilderness, they become a little bit troubled. They become a little bit scared. So now they begin to murmur. They begin to complain. And look at their statement. Their statement is very telling. "Didn't we tell us to leave us alone? Didn't we tell us to let us be slaves to the Egyptians? For it is better to be a slave in Egypt than for us to be corpse in the wilderness." It is very, very strange. Probably they had forgotten about the burden and the yoke of the Egyptians. Or maybe
there had to be a paradigm shift from them exiting Egypt to Egypt exiting their psyche, their thought process, their decision-making had to be truly renewed. So it's important for us to know this. So then Moses responds. Look at what he says. Moses answered the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand firm and you will see the deliverance the Lord will bring you today." So Moses, being one of the greatest leaders in all of history, says to the people, a tough crowd, "Don't you know that," and I'm going to summarize this, "don't you know that God is faithful? The same God who parted the Red Sea, the same God that showed up through signs, through miracles, through the plagues, he is the same God that has promised to deliver you and bring you today from where you are to the final destination that he had mentioned." Now, let me shift gears a little bit, because oftentimes when we talk about deliverance, the last thing that we think about is relationships. But I'm going to tell you today that in order for us to stand firm, I want you to notice that Moses tells the people, "Do not be afraid, stand firm." And if we are going to stand firm, we have to talk about the context and the beauty of godly relationships. Now, when the Bible talks about this beautiful unity in the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 4, verse 12 says, "A person standing alone can be attacked and can be defeated, but two can stand back to back and conquer. Three are even better, for a triple braided cord is not easily broken." Think about that. So when people say, "I got your back," well, the Bible said it first, right? Because if two are standing back to back, you're able to prepare and protect each other's blind spots. Now, but when you have three in the equation, you have a complete 180, a complete 180 of everything that's happening. So today, I want to show you that one of the greatest gifts that you and I have is the gift of godly relationships. And a good example of this was Moses himself. You see, Moses himself experienced the beauty of relationships. Let me give you a little bit of background. God shows up and he speaks to Moses from a burning bush. Now, let me give you context. What's a burning bush? Well, it's a bush that was full of fire, but it would not consume itself, right? And this is a particularly different type of bush, because then God's voice began to be heard audibly by Moses. So could you imagine Moses trembling? So God begins to tell Moses what would happen to his life. God reveals his plans for Moses. And God tells Moses, "I've called you." God tells Moses, "I need you to do this." And he gives them instruction. And what we see in scripture is that Moses, over the next several verses, as it's shown in the Bible, Exodus chapter 3 and Exodus chapter 4, he begins to talk about all the reasons why he's not qualified, when God has already prophesied that that is his destination. And let's pick it up. One of his greatest excuses, and it's a good one, but one of them really speaks about how God unites us to the right people so that we can fulfill our assignment. Exodus chapter 4, verse 10. Look at what the Bible says. "But Moses pleaded with the Lord, 'Oh Lord, I'm not very good with words. I never have been, and I'm not now. Even though you have spoken to me, I get tongue-tied, and my words get tangled.'" I love this. Look what it says. "Then the Lord became angry with Moses." "All right," he said. Look what he says. "All right, you're complaining. You're telling me you can't do it. You're talking to me about all your insecurities and all your weaknesses. All right. What about your brother Aaron, the Levite? I know he speaks well. And look, he is on his way to meet you now. He will be delighted to see you." I love this. "Talk to him and put the words in his mouth. I will be with both of you as you speak, and I will instruct you both in what to do. Aaron will be your spokesman to the people. He will be your mouthpiece, and you will stand in the place of God for him, telling him what to say. So powerful. So here is Moses beginning his ministry, if you will, beginning his reign as the deliverer of the Israelites from the land of Egypt, headed to their promised destination, their promised land. And as God is speaking over Moses about his call, before any of this begins, Moses begins to complain about why he can't and why he shouldn't be able to do this. And then God tells him, well, I'm going to connect you with the right person. And that right person is your very own brother, Aaron. And he, because he can speak, your weakness will be his strength. And when I speak to you, you will dictate to him. And your voice to him will be like my voice to you. Think about that for just 1 second. As I speak to you, Moses, you will receive my instruction. And as you speak to him, he will hear you as if he's hearing the very voice of God. So powerful that God would begin this journey for Moses, highlighting the importance of godly relationships. So let me tell you, what are some things that you should demand, expect, look for in godly relationships? Because I've said this over and over and over again in RWC. Freedom happens in the context of relationships. Freedom happens in the context of relationship. In other words, when you find yourself with someone that loves you enough to encourage you with the truth, loves you enough to speak life where there is sickness, loves you enough to speak faith where there is fear, loves you enough to hear you out, but to pull you from where you are to where God wants you. Amen. So let me tell you what to look for. Number one, godly relationships support us. Godly relationships support us. So Moses is caught with all his insecurities. He mentions all his limitations. He had a past. Yeah, just like you and I had a past, so did he. He was a murderer. That's right. He had murdered an Egyptian soldier. Do you remember? So he had a past. He had insecurities. He was an orphan. So think about the makeup and the resume of Moses. And yet God lifts him up. God makes provision through the life of Aaron so that he could arise to his full potential. See, I remember years ago, my pastor, after a weekday service at the church, I was no older than 19 years old. And my pastor, he called me and he said, Eli, I want to see you after the service. So after the service, I went towards the pastor, and everyone had left the sanctuary, and we sat at the pulpit next to each other, and he told me these words. He says, Eli, I want you, God has great plans for you, and I want you to go to seminary. And for me, when my pastor spoke, that was the voice of God in my life. It really was. And still to this day, when God gives me an opportunity to talk to my mentors, I know that they're used by God. So I still remember saying amen. And exactly what he asked me to do, I did. I enrolled as quickly as I can enroll in Bible seminary, in Bible school. And let me tell you something. I did not know that I would be here today. But my pastor, throughout the journey, he supported me. So I want to ask you today, do you have relationships that support you? Do they keep you honest? Do they hold you accountable? Do they stretch you to honor God? Do they stretch you to honor those that are in authority? Do they push you to be what God has called you to be? I'm also reminded of an event that happened to me about 5 or 6 years ago. I was in Florida, and I was invited to go speak at an anniversary service for a pastor that was celebrating, I believe, about 25, 30 years of ministry. And I was one of the guest speakers. And on Sunday evening, when I was done with my last and final assignment, there was a couple of pastors. One of them was from this area. As a matter of fact, they're both from New England. One of them is stationed in Florida. One of them pastors in the beautiful state of Connecticut, the city of Hartford. And we were driving to go have dinner. Candy and I are in the back of the car, and both of these men of God that I love, that I cherish their relationships, they were in the driver and the passenger side. And all of a sudden, they pull over to the side of the road. A little bit odd, a little bit weird, because we were supposed to be headed to go eat. And I was hungry. I had just finished preaching, right? So they pulled over, and they both looked at Candy and I. And they told us these words. They marked me, and I'll never forget it. They told me, "Pastor Eli, Candy, you cannot fail. Anything and everything that you need in order for you to do what God has called you to do in Western Mass, in the Pioneer Valley, we are here to support you." So the first thing that you will see in a godly relationship is that they will support you. Now, years later, the people of God are in a battle. Exodus chapter 17, verse 10. Look what the Bible says. We're talking about relationships. So Joshua did what Moses had commanded. And Joshua was a great warrior in Moses' corner. And they fought the army of Amalek. Meanwhile, Moses, Aaron, and Ur climbed to the top of the nearby hill. And as long as Moses held up the staff in his hand, the Israelites had the advantage. But whenever he dropped his hand, the Amalekites gained advantage. I want you to see this. Whenever he dropped his hands, the Amalekites, they gained the advantage. Verse 12. So Moses' arms soon became so tired. He could no longer hold them up. So Aaron and Ur found a stone for him to sit on. Then they stood on each side of Moses, holding up his hands, so his hand held steady until the sunset. Now, what this produced, if you read it in the next verse, you'll see that what it produced was a victory for Israel. Now, this is the beauty of relationships. Number one, not only do they support you, but number two, godly relationships strengthen us. They strengthen us. You see, the right relationship will lift you up when you are tired. And if you've ever been tired, you know what I mean. There's nothing more that fills you with great encouragement than for you to be surrounded by people who love you enough and know you enough to be able to notice when you are fatigued, when you are tired, when your hands are getting weary, when your faith is lacking, when you're struggling in your walk. And I don't say that in a demeaning way, but we all need people that surround us to say, "Hey, I'm not going to let you put your hands down. I'm going to lift up your hands. Maybe you can't pray your way out of this one, but I'm going to pray you through this. Maybe you can't fight this on your own for this season, but I'm going to help fight with you. Your blessing has been my blessing, but your struggle will also be my struggle. I'm going to help you throughout this journey." And I love that the Bible says that when they lifted up their hands, when they lifted up the hands of Moses, the people of God prevailed. They knew him enough. And I want you to get this. They knew Moses enough to see that he was tired. They knew him enough to see that he was tired. And I want to challenge you, to every person that is under the sound of my voice, people can't help you if they don't know you. And they don't know you if you continue to push them away. I'm going to say that again. People can't help you if they don't know you. And they will never know you if you continue to push them away unless you let them in. So I know that relationships come with some challenges. So for some of us that have gone through some stuff, hello, somebody. If you've ever been betrayed, talked about. If somebody's blindsided you with betrayal. If you've ever been lied on. Then you know that because of this fallen nature, our relationships are susceptible to some challenges. So it was no different with Moses. So look at what the Bible says, Exodus chapter 32. When the people saw how long it was taking Moses to come back down the mountain. So let me give you some context. So Moses has ascended to the mountaintop to be with the Lord. And God is revealing a pretty big deal of scripture and Jewish history and really of our belief system. God is revealing the Ten Commandments to Moses. Pretty big deal. But the people of God, they got a little weary. They got a little weary because Moses was still in the secret place and he had not come down. So they gathered around Aaron. And they told Aaron, come on, they said, make us some gods who can lead us. We don't know what happened to this fellow Moses. Can you imagine the audacity to just give him that expression, this fellow Moses? Not the great leader, not the one who's had a ton of patience, not the one that has prophesied, not the one that God has used to bring forth life and direction in the wilderness. No, he's just another fellow who brought us here from the land of Egypt. Brought us here from the land of Egypt. So what happens? So Aaron, feeling the pressure of the Israelites, he caves. He caves to the people and he allows them to worship a golden calf. As a matter of fact, not only did he help them, not only did he approve of it, but he was a participator to make sure that their golden calf was created. Exodus chapter 32, verse 21 says, finally, he turned to Aaron and demanded, what did these people do to you to make you bring such terrible sin upon them? So now we fast forward. Moses has made it back down from the mountain. And what he sees is that at the pinnacle of the one of the greatest revelations, one of the greatest experiences that any man had ever had. So he's coming down with this supernatural experience that God has revealed himself to him. And as he's coming down from the mountain, what he sees in the people is idolatry. So, of course, he goes to his mouthpiece. He goes to his brother Aaron, tells him, what did you do to make these people fall into this level of folly, this level of foolishness, this level of sin? So then Aaron replied, don't get so upset, my Lord. You yourself know how evil these people are. You yourself know how evil these people are. Verse 23. They said to me, make us gods who can lead us. We don't know what happened to this fellow Moses who brought us here from the land of Egypt. So I told them, whoever has gold jewelry, take it off. And when they brought it to me, I simply threw it into the fire and out came this calf. You know what this reminds me of? Years ago, I believe it was Chris Rock that had this famous expression, what happened was. So what I'm seeing now is that Aaron is having this moment. What happened was, Moses, that these people, you know how crazy they are. You know how ratchet they are. You know how much pressure they put on you. Well, when you left and didn't come back, they put pressure on me. So what did I do? What could a lonely man like me do? I just asked for their gold. I threw it into the fire and bada bing, bada boom, a golden calf came out. He tried to excuse himself from the responsibility that he was complicit in making this demand, which, by the way, was complete rebellion against God. He was complicit. He was a part of this. Now, here's the lesson. Here's the lesson. Stay with me. Up to this point in the relationship of Moses and Aaron, Moses needed Aaron, right? Because Aaron was the spokesperson. But now things shift. Now things shift in their relationship because here we see an Aaron that now needs Moses. Number three, godly relationships sharpen us. They sharpen us. No, they're not perfect. It would be delusional to think that they're going to be perfect. It would be delusional to think that everything will be perfect. No, it's not perfect. But godly relationships, they sharpen us. Aaron went from being the spokesperson to needing a word of correction. And let me tell you something. You need relationships in your life that will sharpen you. You need relationships in your life that will challenge you. I like to call this multi-directional friendship. The Bible says it this way, Proverbs 27, 17. As iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens another. It's important for you to know that. And number four, godly relationships call out greatness in us. They call out greatness in us. So God speaks to Moses to anoint Aaron and his sons. Let me remind you that all of us have a unique gift. Now, I'm taking a whole lot of history and I'm summarizing it, but I hope that you don't miss that deliverance is the bread of the children of God, and God has made an avenue called godly relationships so that you can find the best version of you. So that you don't just walk out of Egypt, but that you can break with all the traditions, with all the paradigms, with all the faulty thought processes of Egypt that are found within every one of us. So, godly relationships, they call out greatness in us. So God speaks to Moses and says, I need you to anoint Aaron, but I also need you to anoint his sons. And I'm talking about Moses now speaking a generational blessing, not just over Moses, but over his children. Check this out. Exodus chapter 40. Present Aaron and his sons at the entrance of the tabernacle. I love this because we're a portable church. So every time I see tabernacle, I think about portable church. Hello, somebody. So entrance of the tabernacle and wash them with water. Anoint the sons as you did their father. So they may also serve me as priests with their anointing. Aaron's descendants are set apart. That word descendant implies a generational blessing. Doesn't end with Aaron. Doesn't end with his sons. Even till this day, the nation and the tribe, the genealogy of Aaron still occupy their set apart for this. For the priesthood forever from generation to generation. Now, how did this happen? Can I tell you that God anoints them? He speaks forth a generational blessing over them. But then Moses prophesies. Moses does something powerful. The book of Leviticus chapter 8, verse 23 talks about the slain of a ram. And now the blood of the ram, the Bible says that Moses took some of the blood and he applied it to the lobe of Aaron's right ear, then to the thumb of his right hand, and then to the big toe of his right foot. Let me close out today letting you know what Moses was doing. He was declaring, Aaron, you need to be anointed, and you need to receive this blessing in your ears. The blood in the ears was so that Aaron could hear from God. The blood in the right hand was so that Aaron can do the will of the Father. The blood in the foot, in the thumb of the foot, in the toe rather, of the foot of Aaron was that he could walk with God. So Moses was prophesying. Aaron, you're going to hear the voice of God, you're going to do the will of God, and you are going to walk in the ways of God. Now think about that. That is all coming down from one brother to another, from one godly relationship to another. No, it wasn't perfect, but it was ordained by God so that it could bring out the best of Moses and the very best of Aaron. So as I leave you today, this is your Monday application. More than just a to-do, this is more of an opportunity for you to search your own relationships and ask yourself these questions. Number one, do I have friends who support me? And when I talk about supporting, I'm not talking about buying your products. I get that. That's a good gesture. But I'm talking about your spiritual gifts. I'm talking about what God has prophesied over your life. Number two, do I have friends who strengthen me? Do you have someone that strengthens you and that is able to see when you are weak? Number three, do I have friends that sharpen me? They don't accept the mediocre version of me. They want the very best of me. Number four, do I have friends that call out greatness in me? Man, I want to thank God for all my friends. There's never an opportunity that God doesn't give me the honor of preaching about friends that I don't think about the men that surround me, the people that have been by my side for so many years. You see, RWC, if you look at it from afar, it just seems like a church who loves God, is a little bit rowdy, a little bit loud, like the pastor. But really, at the core, man, we're friends. My core team, we're friends. Our worship team, we go back many, many years. So I wanna pray that over you. Now, if you've been listening to this teaching as I get ready to close and you say, see, Pastor, I want deliverance. I want so that God would bring me out, but I also want him to free me. What do I have to do? Well, the first friendship that you need to accept in your life is a friendship with Jesus Christ. See, your next step is to say yes to Jesus. So if that's you right where you are, I want you to repeat this simple prayer. Say, Heavenly Father, I know I've done some wrongs. I also know that you died on the cross for all of my failures. So today, I confess with my mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, that he died for me, and on the third day, he resurrected to give me life. So today, I choose life. Today, I choose Christ. Amen and amen. Welcome to the RWC family and welcome to the body of Christ. There is a next step for you. If you are within an hour of us, check us out next week at 1500 Boston Road as we continue to do both. Right? We are a church on the move, believing God for his absolute best. God bless you.
We're back. Pastor Eli just finished teaching, and it's week two of Behind the Wheel. Now, every week when Pastor is going through his sermon and I'm taking notes and I'm receiving, I'm encouraged. I'm either encouraged or challenged or a little bit of both. And throughout the week, I'm able to reflect even more on the message. I encourage you to do the same. Now, if you're watching this message today and you said to yourself, I want to make a change. I want God to be behind the wheel of my life. I want to give you a hug, like a really big hug, and I want to encourage you, and I got to let you know, you're in answered prayer. We've been praying for you, and we're so excited for what God is about to do in your life. We want to connect with you. So go ahead and send us a text, Know God, to 97000. Or you can also click on the link in the description that says Know God. Our team wants to connect with you. We want to give you those next steps. And once you do so, you'll find a very simple form for some basic information. And I got to let you know, we're not going to use your information for anything that you don't feel comfortable us using it. However, like I said, we want to connect with you, give you those next steps, and walk out your faith walk with you. Now, friends and family, as I mentioned in the beginning of this experience, if you'd like to join us in person for our drive-in experiences, go ahead and register. Our website is rwcchurch.com. We'd love to see you in person. And for those of you who are continuing to join us online, can't wait to see you for midweek. Bye, guys.